Hello, dear my students. Today I'd like to continue the section about the clinical examination of the reproductive tract of cow. In this section, we will discuss about the rectal examination and the vaginal examination. Let's remember our scheme of examination of the non-pregnant cow. We studied before the animal identification and the breeding history, beside the visual inspection of the external genitalia. We should memorize that the aim of the scheme is to reach an accurate diagnosis and accurate prognosis and aid in the suitable treatment decision. Before we started our last session, we emphasized that the knowledge of the anatomy, physiology, and pathology beside the animal behavior is essential to ascertain the disorder or disease of the animal and assure the diagnosis. This aims to answer the following questions. Is the cow pregnant? Is the pregnancy normal? What is the stage of pregnancy? If the cow is not pregnant, is the animal in estrus? What are the signs of estrus? And what are the pathological changes associated with certain disorders like an estrum or repeat breeder? In this section, we will talk about the rectal palpation and the vaginal examination. Before starting the rectal palpation, the examiner and the animal should be prepared for this task. The animal should be well restrained by an assistant in tension. The examiner should wear protective clothes like apron, long plastic sleeve, and rubber boot. The examiner might be need for the use of non-irritating water-soluble lubricant like paraffin oil or an ultrasound gel. Of course, all jewelry, finger rings, and watches must be removed from the hand and arm before insertion of the hand into the cow's rectum. Also, the examiner fingernails should be trimmed and clean. The procedures of examination of the cow reproductive tract bare rectum starts with placement of the gloved and lubricated hand into the rectum by holding the hand in a cone shape, then inserting it through the anus and into the rectum using slow rotating motion with a firm but gentle pressure. Advancing the hand in this manner often stimulates the animal defecation. However, you might need an additional fecal matter to be removed from the rectum manually by what's called back racking. This process may be done by cupping the hand and gently racking the feces caudally toward the anus, allowing them to pass out of the anus beside the arm without removing it from the animal's rectum. Occasionally, during the examination, the rectum may become filled with air, what's called rectal ballooning. This causes the wall of the rectum to be inflated or distended with air, and the wall become tight. When this occurs, the palpation of the internal structures will become difficult or impossible. Normal peristaltic movement of the intestine or rectum will expel this air, but the process may be stimulated by reaching forward and hooking one's finger throughout the peristaltic constriction band and gently pulling it caudally toward the anus. This allows the air to escape beside the arm. It is common for the examiner to encounter peristaltic waves within the rectum during the examination. These are felt as a constriction of the rectum that advances toward the anus. The hand should never be forced through one of these waves. Instead, they should be allowed to pass over the hand and the arm before proceeding with the examination. Finally, in small heifers, severe straining during rectal examination might inhibit the continuation of the procedures, because this kind of straining of the rectal tissue might lead to rectal laceration. If fresh blood or clotted blood over 15 ml in quantity is observed coming from the rectum during the examination, it is prohibited to continue the examination because it indicates rectal rupture. In this condition, the examination should be stopped immediately and supportive therapy should be applied for this cow. The examination is aimed to examine the cervix, uterus, and the ovary. In this video, we can see how the examiner will examine the cow's reproductive organs. After location of the uterus, the examiner should relax or open the flexed uterus to allow examination of all the uterine content and the wall. This start in one horn and then continue to the other horn. Examination also should be directed to examine the ovary to find out what are the ovarian structures present on the ovaries. Of course, right ovary is examined, then continue the examination to the other ovary or the left one.
up and open cow tract. When palpating, one would insert the hands with the fingers together into the rectum. Upon reaching into the rectum, you can then put pressure down on the rectum and sweep the pelvis in order to find the reproductive tract. The first thing that you should find would be the vagina or the cervix. If the reproductive tract is hanging over the pelvis, one can grab the hold of the vagina and lift up, and because it's open, lift the tract up onto the pelvis. On using hand pressure then and moving forward, one then can then locate the cervix, which feels like a chicken neck. Upon finding the cervix, again, you can lift up and pull the tract completely up onto the pelvis, and using your fingers, reach down and find the bifurcation between the uterine horns. And upon getting a hold of the bifurcation, then you can follow the uterine horns down the side and palpate for early pregnancy. If this animal was pregnant, one could maybe find a dirty 35 embryonic vesicle. But as you can see, moving the fingers along, there is no vessel here, or is there any membrane slip that will show in pregnancy. You can also then follow the horns down and find the ovaries. And in this case, these are very small ovaries with not very large structures. But one can put the fingers on the ovaries and rub the fingers across, feeling for a CL or a follicle. Upon looking at the right ovary, one can then follow along and get on to the left uterine horn and again palpate through the horn, finding the ovaries and palpating it in order to find if any ovarian structures are present, determine if cyclicity or non-cyclicity is occurring. Upon thorough examination of the uterine horns, one then can determine, at least in this case, if animals were bred at day 60, that this animal is truly open, if one can basically lift up and find and put both horns in their hand. Of an open cow tract.
After viewing the technique examination, we will start in details how to examine the cervix. The cervix of cow is a unique structure within the reproductive tract because it represents the main landmark for palpation of the cow reproductive organs. Therefore, it is essential to locate the cervix before proceeding in examining the other parts of the cow reproductive tract. But how to find the cervix? Once the hand and arm become in the rectum and the feces and air have been removed, the cow cervix can be located. Usually, the cervix lies in the midline of the pelvic floor, but may be displaced laterally by a full urinary bladder or due to short blood ligament. To find the cervix, slide the hand down one wall of the pelvic cavity and across the pelvic floor of the opposite wall. Feeling for a firm, cylindrical, somewhat irregular structure which indicates the cervix lying parallel within the axis with the axis of the cow. Once the cervix located, it should be grasped up and backwardly into the pelvic cavity. You should note that the early pregnant cow or open cow, the grasping of the uterus and moving it is quite easy, but it is difficult in pregnant cows. In certain breeds, like short-horn cows, the cervix might be extended over the pelvic brim and lie partially in the pelvic cavity. What are the criteria for examination of the cervix? The cervix is examined for the size, shape, form, consistency, and position. The size of the cervix, as we know in the mature cow, is ranged from 5 to 12 cm in length and 2 to 6 cm in diameter. This size undergo little change or marked change with the age, parity, and the course of the estrus cycle. About the shape. As we said, the cervix is a unique structure, cylindrical in form, lies between the uterus cranial and the vagina caudal. How about the form? The cow cervix characterized by presence of 4 to 5 annular rings. Besides, it contains excessive amount from the connective tissue. This is responsible for its thick texture. The annular folds of the cervical mucosa should be evaluated. In aged cows, you can see prolapse of the fifth ring or the last ring into vaginal cavity. About examination of the consistency of the cervix. The cow cervix is characterized by cartilaginous firm feeling texture, which resembles a turkey neck. About the position of the cervix. The cervix lies in the midline of the pelvic floor, and this position undergo changes with a full urinary bladder or pregnancy. Inserted breed, as we said before, like short horn, the cervix might be extended into the caudal part of the abdominal cavity. Like in this picture. Let's move to the next part on examination of the uterus. The uterus might move cranially into the caudal part of the abdominal cavity, and this causes difficulty in examination of the uterus. Therefore, the uterus might be need to be retracted into the pelvic cavity. The key for reliable examination of the reproductive tract by rectal palpation is dependent on successful retraction of the entire uterus into the pelvic cavity. Therefore, it should be retracted to the pelvis to allow a complete examination of the uterine hornets and ovaries. How can we do direct or indirect retraction of the uterus? The direct retraction of the uterus depends basically on retraction of the uterus from the ventral intercoronal ligament manipulation, while the indirect retraction depends on retraction of the uterus depending on manipulation of the broad ligament. Once the uterus is retracted into the pelvic cavity, it is examined for the size, form, consistency, tone, and content. The size of the uterus. The size of the uterus is variable, as we said, with the number of parity. The size of the uterus, number one, which means its diameter equal one finger diameter. This occurs in heifers and primeval cows. Medium size, which means the diameter equal two fingers. This occurs in pluriparous animals due to previous parturitions. Big size uterus equal three fingers in diameter. This occurs in aged or senile animals, also occur during early pregnancy and in pathological disorders. Very big uterus, which means the uterus is four fingers in diameter, this occurs in pregnancy or in pyometra. An extremely big uterus, which means the circumference of the uterus cannot be reached with hand, this occurs in late pregnancy or early postpartum period. About the form and shape of the uterus. The uterus in open cow or non-pregnant cow characterized by symmetric size of the two hornets, while one horn become markedly bigger, which mean asymmetry. This occurs in case of pregnancy or pathological condition like biometra. The uterine tone or contractions is examined, which indicate the stage of the estrus cycle. The uterus become non-contracted or flabby during the diestrous phase due to high progesterone level. The uterus show moderate contractility characterized by slight turgidity during proestrus in association with moderate estrogen level in the blood. Strong contractions or high tone characterized by turgidity and direction of the uterus. This occur during estrus due to high estrogen level. The uterine wall and uterine content are examined also. The uterine content can be fluctuated, which means it is water-like sac, which occurs during pregnancy, hydropsy, and mucometra. Dewy texture, which means thick uterine content beside edematous wall, can be observed during biometra. The uterine wall thickness are examined. We can see the uterine wall thickness become thinner in association with pregnancy or hydrometra, and it become thicker in metritis and biometra. Uterine surface, it is normally to examine the uterine surface and it become smooth without any roughness or any abnormal protruding structures. However, an abnormal uterine surface characterized by roughness, this occurs in parametritis, perimetritis, and tuberculosis. How about the movability of the uterus? The uterus is normally movable. As we said before, it can be easily retracted into the pelvic cavity. Abnormal uterus is characterized by immobility due to adhesions with the surrounding structures, and this occurs in parametritis, perimetritis, and tuberculosis. We can also examine the uterus for congenital anomalies like uterus unicornuus. In this case, we can see there is aplasia in one uterine horn. Let's move towards the examination of the next part of the female reproductive tract, which is the ovary. The ovary is located by finding it in relation to the tip of the uterine horn, or by recapturing the broad ligament and locating the ovary, which is suspended by the mesometrium. Once the ovary is found, it's held so that the ventral or free border faces dorsal, while the dorsal or attached border rests in the hand. The surface of the ovary is explored using the forefinger and the thumb, allowing the examiner to evaluate the ovarian size, consistency, presence of functional or pathological structure on the ovary. The characteristics of the ovary vary between ovaries even in the same individual and with the age and the breed. We can found that the prepubertal heifer has small and smooth ovary, while those post-puberty have an ovarian size more than 2 cm in length and 1 cm in width. This picture show how to grasp the ovary to palpate it between the forefinger and thumb. The ovarian structures can be felt by fingers, might be physiological or pathological. Physiological structures can be seen are corpus luteum and follicle. The corpus luteum characterized by its larger size, which is 2.5 to 3 cm in diameter. This structure is thick and hepatized with irregular surface and rough wall. It has a distinct neck which make it more protruded above the ovarian surface. In contrary, the follicle appears smaller in diameter, around 1 to 2 cm in diameter. Its texture is fluctuated. It has a convex surface, thin wall, and its contour is slightly protruded above the ovarian surface. You might see a pathological structure on the ovary, like ovarian cyst. This is a large fluctuated structure, resembling the follicle, but it is larger than 2.5 centimeter in diameter. You might see a pathological structure, but away from the ovarian boundaries, like para-ovarian cyst. About the vaginal examination. The vaginal examination requires the use of special instrument like vaginoscope or vaginal dilator with the help of light source. This image shows the internal wall of vagina examined by the vaginoscope. This image shows a purulent cervical discharge come out from the vagina or vaginoscope during the vaginal examination. You can see abnormal changes in the vaginal cavity or the cervix during vaginal examination by vaginoscope. On the left image, you can see urine pooling in the cranial vagina. On the left side, you can see the mid-estrus bleeding, which characterizes the cow 2 days after the end of estrus. This image shows the changes in the cervical rings in association with a stage of the estrus cycle. In image number one, the cervix during the estrus. In image number two, characterizes the cervix during the estrus onset, which is characterized by swelling of the cervix and it starts to be opened. The folds are less defined. In picture number three, characterizes the cervix at the end of estrus. In here, the cervix is swollen and relaxed. The cervical folds hangs down, appearing very vascular. Picture number four characterizes the cervix during pregnancy. In this case, the cervix is very hard, tightly closed, and covered with pasty mucus. In this image, we can see watery cervical discharge that contain whitish-yellowish flakes of pus, which characterizes the internal contamination or infection of the uterus. The left image show the open cervix at time of estrus, while the right image show a purulent oxidate come out from the cervix. Picture upward show the cervical fold is swollen and prolapsed without reddening. In the downward picture, we can see the cervical folds are swollen, prolapsed with reddening, which indicate cervicitis. You might need to use certain tools to examine the uterine content, like metricheck device. This device helps to collect the uterine lumen content, which is exposed to evaluation for scoring. Score number 0 mean clear or translucent mucus. Score number 1 indicate mucus containing flakes of white or off-white pus. Score number 2 indicates discharge containing less than 50% of white mucopurulent material. Score number 3 characterizes discharge in the uterus contain more than 50% of purulent material, which is white or sanguineous in color. You might use Fincher pencil test to examine the vaginal cavity lens. In normal mature cow, the vaginal lens is around 30 cm long. However, in cows with congenital anomaly like Ferry-Martinez, you might notice that the vaginal cavity is less than 10 cm in length. You can use also sheath kink test to examine the Ferry-Martin cough. Or you can use a special designed Ferry-Martin probe for the young heifers. This image shows how to place the Ferry-Martin probe into the heifer's vagina. This probe is designed to be used in heifers 30 days or less in age. In this age, the normal heifer vagina is 14 cm, but in Ferry-Martin heifer, it will be 7 cm or less in length. We can use the vaginal examination to examine the health status of the uterine wall by using double guarded cytology brush and swab, and this aimed to examine the cytological content of the uterine wall. The evidence of neutrophils in between the epithelial cells indicate the condition of endometritis. This examination is helpful to assess the normal uterine involution or metritis by examining the cow's genitalia at 15, 30, and 60 days postpartum. Of course, this in association with clinical examination, ultrasound investigation, and evaluation of the peripheral blood picture. We come to our the end of our session. We studied the clinical examination of the non-pregnant cow, and I recommend this site for my students to learn more about the normal and abnormal pictures of the female reproductive tract. Thank you all.